What's up, Exeters? So today we're here in Jacksonville, Florida, more specifically on the corner of Mull and Woodcrest. Now, back in the 50s to about the 80s, this area was known as Shantytown.
Jacksonville, Florida, the West Side. It's here that a group of young boys once shared their dream to make music. A dream touched by tragedy, but music that lives on.
Who exactly called this place Shantytown from the 50s and the 80s? 50s to the 80s. Well, that would be none other than three guys by the name of Ronnie, Donnie, and Johnny. Now, those names might sound familiar because those were the Van Zant boys, two of which became lead singers of the legendary Lynyrd Skynyrd, and the other one, the founding member and lead singer of 38 Special. We're here at 5419 Woodcrest Road, the home of the Van Zant boys, and they would call this place home from the 1950s to the 1980s.
The Van Zants grew up in this house. Ronnie called the neighborhood Shantytown. It's been so long since I've been gone. Another day here
might be too long for me. It's a nice little house. It's now a Airbnb. So if you're ever in the area and would like to stay in the Van Zant house, look them up.
So like he was saying, it is on Airbnb, but when I was researching it, I think they have divided it into rooms now where actually you can rent a room for like a week or so instead of the whole house. And another thing I was reading about when they were fixing it up, they've put like Lynyrd Skynyrd memorabilia, some of that in the house. So it would be pretty cool to get in there and see and to stay, like he was saying. But originally, this house was smaller because the dad, they lived here with mom and dad, obviously. Dad was a truck driver, and he actually built on to the house. Now, even after Lynyrd Skynyrd took off and their sons became famous in the rock community, their parents continued to live here.
So while Ronnie, Donnie, and Johnny Van Zant were all growing up here at the house, they all three shared a room. Now, I don't know what it's like to have too many younger brothers, but I imagine having to share a room probably got a little tense at times. Now, their mother, Mrs. Van Zant, was known to the neighborhood and the community as Sister. That was her nickname. She fed everybody. Like, she made sure nobody went hungry. She was always cooking. So I imagine this was probably the spot to hang out and the place to be growing up. You know, you in that young age up to teenage years, I imagine this house was full of freaking kids packing their stomachs full.
Marion Van Zant remembers her son Ronnie's public debut.
First day he went to school, he sat in the corner with a dunce hat on his head. Singing Ricochet Romance and Beer Drinking Daddy in the classroom.
So growing up, they really didn't have a ton of money. So you have to think, they're not living like with 700 channels like we're used to. It was reported that they only grew up with four channels. So basically you had to find something to do. It was in this house that they all learned to sing and play instruments.
So this is in front of the Van Zant house. There's a nice plaque here from calling it a Florida Heritage Site. This fence right here, this very nice black iron fence with two gates on the driveway, was not original. This used to be a chain link fence, and the guy that bought the house and turned it into an Airbnb put this fence up. He also put up the security cameras all over the house, and he was able to get them to make this plaque and put it up outside. That kind of gives you a brief, very compact history on the Van Zandt house and Lynyrd Skynyrd and Donnie from 38 Special. A very nice touch.
And I know they can't see it because we don't have the zoom lens, but the flower garden back there is a nice touch, yep, too.
There's a flower garden that runs right here, and in front of it, it says Free Bird Garden. Our next stop is here at Hyde Park Elementary School. And this would have been the elementary school the guys attended while they were kids. So it wasn't just Ronnie and his brothers that attended this elementary school. There was also other bandmates that attended here at Hyde Park Elementary School. Nice little school here in Jacksonville. Just a short walk from Hyde Park Elementary School is the infamous baseball field that kind of started Lynyrd Skynyrd in a way. So, story goes that Ronnie Van Zandt hit a foul ball that struck Bob Barnes in the head.
We were on the third baseline just standing there watching, and Ronnie got up to bat. We didn't really know him, and he hit a foul ball real hard and hit Bob right in the head and knocked him out.
And now Bob Barnes would go on to be future bandmate and the original drummer for Lynyrd Skynyrd. So he gets hit in the head, knocks him unconscious. Ronnie and his friend Gary Rosington, who would become the lead guitarist for Lynyrd Skynyrd, runs over to check on Barnes, who woke up a few minutes after, you know, they got over there.
And we freaked out, and he ran over there, and he said, "Bob," you know, he didn't know him. "Oh, man, I killed this guy."
And the three guys got to talking. They got to talking about music, which led to the conversation of, "Hey, we're going to start a band." And Ronnie's like, "We are starting a band, and I'm going to be a lead singer."
He woke up, and after the game, then we got together and talked. And we said, "Hey, you play drums, and you play guitar, and you sing. Let's." So we went right down the road to Bob's house and started playing.
And thus, the legendary Lynyrd Skynyrd was born.
So when I was, you know, reading the story and hearing him talk about it, like, the only thing that I could hear and, like, play through my mind is whenever he was like, "We're going to start a band, and I'm going to be the lead singer." But I'm picturing Jack Black, you know, like, where he, you know how he has those epiphanies, like, in School of Rock, where he does, like, the eyebrow up like that?
Yeah.
And like, the song, what is it? We created the greatest song in the world, or whatever. What's that one? Yeah, like that's all I can think of. Like, "We're going to start a band, and I'm going to be the lead singer. And it's going to be the greatest southern rock band in the world." I'm trying to do the eyebrow right now, but it's not working.
But he was right. It did end up being the greatest southern rock band in the world. So you got to kind of give it to him and his arrogance. I mean,
well, I mean, he didn't say it was going to be the greatest southern rock band. I'm just...
Oh, I'm sure he was probably...
I'm totally Jack Black in it right now. Like, I'm... These little boys, I mean, I don't... It didn't really say how old they were, but I'm assuming maybe they came over after school one day. So maybe they're still elementary school age. If that's wrong, then somebody definitely put it in the comments how old they were. But I don't know. I'm just...
I mean, but...
He's a tiny Jack Black in my mind at this moment.
So just a block or so up from the Van Zandt house, this lot once set Woodcrest Grocery. Now, we'll insert a picture here so you guys can see what it looked like. But this is where Ronnie used to work, and he would sit out here while he's working and listen to older men play and sing the blues, which then inspired him to write The Ballad of Curtis Lowe. So just over my shoulder, you see this green building. It's the Jug. So early on in their career, the guys had stopped here at the Jug to have a few beers before playing a local dance. This woman comes up to Ronnie and asks him, "Hey, Want to have a dance? Yeah, Ronnie obliged. I said, sure. Well, not long after, the woman's husband come busting through the door, threatening Ronnie with his life. So, you know, he took a couple steps back, got out of there. Well, when they get back in the vehicle to drive away, none of the guys say anything about what had just happened. But Alan Collins kind of starts muttering something to the effect of, I was cutting a rug down at a place called The Jug. And thus, Gimme Three Steps was born. The open lot that you see in front of you is where the infamous Hell House once stood. Now, this building burned down, but the landowner that developed this neighborhood was such a big Lynyrd Skynyrd fan that he didn't allow anyone to build on this property and actually named some of the streets after Lynyrd Skynyrd's songs. Now, this place had running water and it had electricity, but it had no air. So the band members would actually load up together early in the morning times, drive, set their equipment up, and practice all day until late in the evening, and then leave and go home. Now, the reason they named this Hell House is because with no AC and being in the hot Florida sun, it would get extremely blistering hot inside here, practicing all day. Now, in between takes, just on the far side, is a creek where the guys could fish between takes and where Ronnie would actually sit down there on the pier and write his songs while the guys were up in the house practicing the music part. So the only reason I'm not going down there is because this is a residential neighborhood. It is gated. It does still say private property. So to keep the cops from getting called on me again, I'm just going to stand right here on the edge and let you guys see where Hell House used to stand.
But I did venture down there.
Renee is did venture down there to get some TikTok rebel. Video.
No, I didn't do that. I just wanted to look. I'm a rebel. So
she's a rebel without a cause.
The pier,
or with a cause.
There's no pier down there anymore. Because there used to be that platform. It's just some wooden pole. Like, I don't know what they're called.
I mean, it looked like from the
it's
pictures.
It's not a floor you can stand on.
It looked like it's been flooded several times from some of the pictures we've seen, so. The infamous Hell House. I wish they would have rebuilt the replica. That would have been pretty sweet. So we're here on Brickyard Road, just across the train tracks here. You'll see this Brickyard A662.4 in the background, just across from that is a driveway. Now, this driveway led about a quarter of a mile down here. No trespassing, camera in use. But the reason we're here is because this is where Ronnie Van Zant lived during the time of his death. Now, he lived here with his wife, Judy, and their daughter, Melanie. The house was sold after Ronnie's passing, and it was later torn down. So you can't get down this road. I mean, there's keep out, no trespassing, security cameras in use. I mean, signs on both sides of the road. But the legend once lived a quarter mile down this road.
Our next stop on the Lynyrd Skynyrd tour, we've made it to Doctor's Lake. Now, as you can see, this is a pretty popular lake. People have got their piers built out there from their homes, their boats. And this was also where Gary and Ronnie were fishing in the 1970s Pepsi Cola tribute to Lynyrd Skynyrd's video in the opening shots.
I don't consider myself a star at all. I'm just normal as anybody.
Now, it just so happens that sitting on this lake also is a restaurant called Whitey's Fish Camp that is just over to our left. What you're looking at now is the back of Whitey's Fish Camp, where you can eat outside of the restaurant and have a nice view of the lake. but several of the interviews with the band in Freebird, the movie, were filmed actually on the dock. This is the front of Whitey's Fish Camp, and this was Ronnie Van Zant's favorite restaurant to eat, very close to where he actually lived on Brickyard Road. I mean, I would say it's probably like 5-10 minutes from here. And, you know, even though they're not with us anymore, present day, there's some Skynyrd band members that still frequent the restaurant, including his brother, Johnny Van Zant, and people from Molly Hatchet. I saw where they also did like a little tribute whenever Gary Rosington passed. So the restaurant still very much is rich with Lynyrd Skynyrd history and will seem to be continue to do so. We're walking up on 4734 Julington Creek Road. So this house right over here is Alan Collins' home whenever he passed away. He had this house built around 1975, around the time when the band had started becoming successful. Now, if you'll notice that bigger part over there on the left side, that's where he would keep like antique cars and, you know, all his other kind of antique items. In the back of the house, he had a full-blown studio where he would, this was where the Rosington Collins band did some of their writing and early rehearsals. He was still living in this house in 1990 when he passed away from pneumonia, which was complications from the massive injuries and paralysis that he obtained from that wreck he had just around the corner.
In January 1986, less than a mile, I would say, dare say less than a half a mile from his house at the time, Alan Collins and his current girlfriend were speeding along. Alan had been drinking, so of course, you know, he's driving. And they estimated he was doing around 80 miles an hour when he lost control, ran off the road, and hit this culvert right here. The crash would kill his girlfriend instantly. The crash would also cut short Alan's musical career by causing him to be paralyzed from the waist down. He wouldn't play anymore. He would go on to be the musical maestro, so to speak, for the band during their 1987 anniversary reunion of the plane crash. He would also oftentimes open for the band by giving a talk about the dangers and consequences of drinking and driving. But sadly, Alan's life would be cut short due to pneumonia, often complication from being paralyzed, and he would pass away in 1990. Here at Riverside Memorial Park Cemetery, to find the resting places of a few of the members of Lynyrd Skynyrd.
Someday I'm going to be the best bass guitar player in the world or something like that, something similar to that. And when he said it, we had no idea he'd become as famous as he did with the Lynyrd Skynyrd group.
Well, our first stop here, Riverside Memorial Park Cemetery, is for none other than the bass guitarist, Mr. Leon Wilkinson. Now, Leon wouldn't pass away in the plane crash, but he did get pretty beat up. Leon, we're talking about a double compound closed fracture of his left leg. The man had some teeth dislodged. He had a few broken ribs, one of which punctured his left lung. His left arm was so badly broken and messed up that doctors actually considered, you know, amputating the arm. And then to top all that off, the swamp water from where the plane crashed was like severely infecting all of his wounds. So Leon had it rough. Now Leon would go on to heal from his injuries and actually rejoin the band during their 1987 reunion tour, which was the 10th annual or 10th anniversary of that fatal plane crash. Now, because of the damage he suffered, if you notice in his tombstone right here how he's got the bass guitar real hugged close to his chest and almost in a vertical position, that was due to the fact that he was suffering from severe nerve damage and limited range of motion from the injuries he had sustained 10 years prior. So he actually had to play like this, which ended up being, you know, his own style and his own way of playing that nobody else played like. So with that being said, I mean, he's got a good tombstone. I love they got bass guitar on both sides. I love the fact they put him in his hat because he was known for wearing all different kind of hats, his beard, and they actually put him in his new playing style that he developed after the crash. So
I love the hat. The hat's he had style.
Yeah, the man loved his hat. I mean, he had a lot of different hats that he wore. And if we go over here, there's actually a picture of him in another hat. Mr. Leon right there. Now this would have been pre-crash, because you can see he's holding it like a normal bass player, not hugged up like this one right here. See how it's almost in a vertical? So, fly on, proud bird, you're free at last. So just as you come through the gates here at Riverside Memorial Park Cemetery, just to the left, as you get to this little roundabout that's behind me, on the left is the Van Zandt family plot. Now, here buried in the middle is Ronnie's dad and mother, Lacey and Marion. On the right is Tammy, which is Ronnie's oldest daughter. And then on the left is Frances, Darlene, Ronnie's sister. We got a nice little bench out here. Nice little plot. Now, Ronnie is buried somewhere else in the cemetery. He's not here with the family, but we'll find that grave in a minute. So just a short walk across the road from Leon's resting place, we're walking over to Mr. Billy Powell, who was the piano player for Lynyrd Skynyrd.
I sat down, played in my version Freebird, and their jaws dropped to the ground. I said, "Man, you mean to tell me you've been playing the piano like that and didn't tell us?"
Now, Billy died in 2009 from a heart attack he suffered at his home here in Florida. But during the plane crash, Billy survived, obviously. But he almost had his nose completely torn off from the plane, along with several lacerations to his face and several deep lacerations to his leg. But that didn't stop Billy. He mended his wounds. He kept playing. And he continued to tour with Lynyrd Skynyrd until his heart attack, January 28th of 2009. So here's Mr. Billy Powell's final resting place. And I just, much like Leon's, I just love how his tombstone is a grand piano. Not just any piano, not an upright, not a short, not a standard, but a grand piano, which is what he played most often with Lynyrd Skynyrd. Not only that, but on the little bench over here, it said he played it pretty. Now, I don't know exactly why this saying is on here, But for me, what I am speculating is due to the fact that every night, or nearly every night, whenever it was time to play Freebird, as he was playing, Mr. Ronnie would say, play it pretty. Play it pretty for Atlanta. Play it pretty for Jacksonville. Play it pretty for Alabama. Anywhere they were at, play it pretty. And he did. One of the finest piano players I think I've ever seen and never heard. Rest in peace, Mr. Powell. Long live your music. So just a short stone throw from Billy Powell's resting spot, we come to a man that was a musical genius in his own right. His cause of death in 2023 was not disclosed, but he was the final original member of Lynyrd Skynyrd to pass away. Now, during the fatal plane crash of 1977, he suffered a lot. The door actually landed on him, causing him to break both arms, both wrists, both legs, both ankles, and his pelvis. Now, for most people, that would be done. You know, I ain't doing nothing ever again. I'm healing my wounds. I'm sitting around the house. This did not stop this man. He healed his wounds. He picked his guitar back up. He went back out there and played. And we're talking about none other than the legendary, the simple man, Mr. Gary Rosington.
I want him to be a good person and just be himself and not try to do anything phony, you know. I guess that's where he got it, but he meant, you know, he was just a simple person, simple man.
So here is Gary's final resting place. Love they got the rebel flags up there and all of the flowers. Now, since he did just pass recently, he does not have a headstone out here yet. But I gotta say, this is a good substitute. Good substitute for the man. And as you can see right here, the simple man. Gary Robert Rosington. Play on, Gary. Fly high. So our next grave stop is still in the same cemetery, but it's kind of across the road. It's the second part of it. We're heading to a guy who is a legendary guitarist in his own right. During the fatal plane crash, he survived, but he broke two vertebrae in his neck. He would go on to form two different bands. One was the Rosington Collins Band, short-lived, and then another band with Lynyrd Skynyrd members Leon and Billy Powell, which was also short-lived. Then in 1986, he was in a near-fatal car accident that killed his current girlfriend at the time and leaving him paralyzed from the waist down. So his music career was cut way too short from drunk driving. He would serve as maestro and band leader during the 10th anniversary reunion of the fatal crash, although he was unable to play. We're talking about none other than the great, legendary Alan Collins. ¶¶ So here's the final resting place of Mr. Larkin Allen Collins Jr. Him and his wife, Kathy. Now, his wife, Kathy, died in 1980, which kind of just stacked on to the stuff that Allen was dealing with, leading him to that fatal for his current girlfriend and leaving him paralyzed in the single car crash from where he had been drinking. Passed away January 29th, 1990. Rebel flags, just like everybody else, leaving little guitars. Now, right across from his resting place, just under this tree, is a bench that has Collins on it. Now, whether or not that's related to him or not, but it is right across, so. And if you're looking for a marker when you come in, if you look at this crucifix, find the white crucifixion statue, and as you head towards it, he's just on the south side or the front side. Just before you get to a few sites down, rest in peace, Alan. You sure could wail on that guitar. Just don't think the Freebird solo would have been as awesome if you hadn't have been the one playing it. So we can't do this video on Lynyrd Skynyrd without talking about the person the New York Times called the most influential gym coach in American pop culture. That's pretty awesome. You got that New York Times.
Gym coaches, you need to aspire.
Need to take note from this man. So this man, he hated long hair, which often sent a lot of his students to the principal's office, including members of the band Lynyrd Skynyrd.
A lot of teachers and a lot of coaches sent a lot of boys and girls down for violation of the dress code. But lucky me, one of the ones I sent down was in this band. And so I became famous by accident, I guess.
He is a rock music folk figure on top of all of this. And he was the gym coach of the guys at Robert E. Lee High School during the 60s.
Yeah.
So the thing that makes this man even more special, and the reason we're here to honor his grave also, is it's none other than gym coach Lynyrd Skynyrd.
My name is Lynyrd Skynyrd, and I spell it Lynyrd Skynyrd.
So here is the final resting place of Mr. F. Lynyrd Skynyrd. He was a corporal in the U.S. Army in Korea, even says dedicated coach. So he was actually, later in life, was actually, you know, very good friends with some of the members of Lynyrd Skynyrd, like Gary Risington, Ronnie Van Zant, Leon Wilkinson, and even Gene Odom, who was the bodyguard of Ronnie.
So they, of course, you can notice the spelling of his name is different. They actually changed the spelling of the name in 1972. But they also used him for inspiration when it came to their third album, Nut and Fancy, in 1975, which used a sign from his real estate business that featured his name and telephone number. So, like, thousands of fans of Lynyrd Skynyrd were calling this dude up. Like, you sent us to the principal's office. That's the ultimate get back.
Yeah. We're putting your name, your phone number, and everything on our freaking album. That way everybody can call you all hours of the night. say you don't like long hair anymore. So aspiring gym coaches and, just school personnel in general. Doesn't have to be a coach. Dedicated coach right here. The legendary Lynyrd Skynyrd. Take note. Be good to your students. But, teach them well. Maybe you have a band named after you. Our final resting place for the legendary Lynyrd Skynyrd is just a short walk up this beautiful brick path. Now this path leads to none other than the legendary, the magnificent lead singer, Mr. Ronnie Van Zant.
He was a rare person. He had a quality about him that it just reeked of greatness. He never wrote anything down. It was always in his head. Never wrote anything down. And he was a genius. He had just so many ideas.
And there he is, 1948 to 1977. Nice dove, looking like a free bird.
If I leave it's hard. You still remember.
Here he is. Now, Ronnie was not always buried here at Riverside. Originally, his remains was buried at Jacksonville Memory Garden. But in June of 2000, his resting place, along with guitarist Steve Gaines, was vandalized. Now, because their graves over at Jacksonville Memory Garden were vandalized, this prompted the Van Zant family to move Ronnie from there over here to Riverside to be buried here with the rest of his family. Now, obviously, his family is not behind me. This is his spot. So in 1975, Ed King, one of the guitarists for Lynyrd Skynyrd, who's, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, his family was originally from California.
Ed King was a guitar player from the South. Well, sort of.
Southern California.
But he ended up writing the tune, the for Sweet Home Alabama, oddly enough, being from California. So anyway, in 1975, Ed King leaves the band. Don't really know why. But the band had strongly considered, at that point, looking for a third guitarist. They still had Gary Rosington. They still had Alan Collins, but now Ed King has left. So, Cassie was like, hey, my little brother Steve can play. Cassie was one of the backup singers for Lynyrd Skynyrd. Steve had been playing with other bands here and there. She knew he could play, so she's like, hey, give me a shot. So, she calls up Steve and convinces him to leave his home in Oklahoma and drive to Kansas where Skynyrd was going to be playing. That night, he plugs into this tiny little Fender amp. He only gets to play one song, T for Texas. The amp was so small that nobody could really hear him, but Gary Rosington did. Gary Rosington, being a founding member and the lead guitarist for Lynyrd Skynyrd, he made such a lasting impression on Gary that eventually Ronnie would call him up and say, hey, you're going to be the new third guitarist for Lynyrd Skynyrd.
So new member of Lynyrd Skynyrd's name is Steve Gaines over here. He's Oklahoma. He's Okie. Watch out, I'm going to sick of Okie on you.
So that night, he plays T for Texas. It really made an impression on Gary and Alan because Gary and Alan on T for Texas had a lot of solos between the two, back and forth, back and forth. So to be different, Steve comes out, puts on a slide, and plays the song with a slide on guitar, thus cementing his legacy and membership in the band of Lynyrd Skynyrd. We'll be right back. But here is the final resting place of Mr. Steve Gaines here in the Jacksonville Memory Gardens. I like how it looks like he's got, can't tell if it's a, I want to say that's a fire pit thing on top. Died in the plane crash October 20th, 1977, along with frontman Ronnie Van Zant and his sister Cassie and the assistant road manager, along with the two pilots. And well, I'm not that way. Now, him and his sister both are laid to rest here in the Gaines family plot. Now, if we look right over here, let me brighten it up some since we're going in the shade. Now, his sister Cassie and both of their parents are both laid to rest here. You got Bud and Cassie LaRue, and then the daughter, oddly enough, Cassie LaRue, died just under 2 years from her mom. So right next to the Gaines family plot is what used to be the resting place of legendary frontman, singer-songwriter, and leader of Lynyrd Skynyrd, Mr. Ronnie Van Zant. Now, Ronnie is no longer buried here. He is actually over at the Riverside Memorial Park Cemetery. So the reason he's no longer here is because several years ago, both his and Steve's graves were both vandalized. So the Van Zant family actually had him exhumed and put over at Riverside, which is also where the Van Zant family plot is, along with several of the other members of Lynyrd Skynyrd. But they left this original tomb here. So as you can see, this is a pretty good size tomb. It would look like he was actually would have been buried above ground, maybe in this, versus being buried in the ground because of how tall it is. But it is nice that they buried him right next to Cassie and Steve, since the three of them did pass away in the plane crash together. I thought that's a pretty nice touch. So this is our final stop on the Lynyrd Skynyrd tour. Here at the Ronnie Van Zant Memorial Park at 2760 Sand Ridge Road. Now over to the left, all this area is a park. They got basketball courts, tennis courts. Feels like either saw, I don't know, a bunch of other stuff. They even got frisbee golf, a playground park for the little kids.
This park opened in 1990, and it's 90 acres big, so it's a big park. It's funded by the Freebird Foundation.
Nice. Yeah, I mean, it's huge. I mean, this park goes from, we parked over here, and every bit of this, there's your frisbee golf, more parking, tennis courts, pickleball courts, basketball courts, even a restroom building. So
I wouldn't recommend that, though.
Need a little clean up in the restroom building. A little better upkeep, so. Well, I hope you guys enjoyed all things Lynyrd Skynyrd. This was a great video for us to make. Thoroughly enjoyed hitting all of these spots. So, special shout out to our Patreon subscriber, our VIP Road Warrior, the Crypt Lady. Thanks for your support. So if you haven't subscribed yet, subscribe to this channel here on YouTube, but also go over to our Patreon. You can find all of our links on Linktree, Exit to Adventure, Patreon, Exit to Adventure. We have different tiers, so consider subscribing. Also have an Amazon wish list, which is also under Exit to Adventure. And if you haven't done so already, check out our TikTok. We do a lot of lives there. Gonna start anytime we are filming our paranormal investigations on this channel, we will also be doing a subscribers only live on TikTok. So if you'd like to check it out live, head on over to TikTok, subscribe to the channel, and thanks in advance for your support and your patronage. So, well, we'll catch you guys down the road at the next exit.
Keep it spooky.
Later.
I'm with some friends that I once said, times they change, but I'll be glad when I go home.